Sin after the cross. I can't tell you how many people that I talk with who believe in Jesus, have the Spirit, and mess up. Just look around the room. There isn't a person on the side or in front of you, behind you, that does not sin after they become a believer. But I will tell you, I will always ask this question when they are stuck. Do you love you? Right now. Do you love you?
Yeah.
Why do you love you? Because God loves you. See, this is the foundation of our healing. If we don't have that foundation, we're really going to be stuck, right? And not that we should discount sin after we believe. We need to own it and talk about it. Amen? Yeah. We're going to review some of those things scripturally today. But without an assurance that God loves you, you will be and feel unloved. And that will hinder you from going forward. And this is the question. So when we ask people, did God love you before you knew him? Yes. Yes. He loved you then, it said. So when you became a believer, it says, how much more does he love you that you've been reconciled, that you came to Christ? So when you didn't know him, it said Christ died for you. When you were yet a sinner, how much more... What am I, Steve Martin? What is that? It's kind of weird. Sorry. I'm a quality Christian guy. How much more that you're in Christ? So let me ask you. Does he love you when you should sin as a believer?
Yes.
Then why do we struggle with it?
Yes. Yes.
That's what we're going to talk about today. Because I believe we're not going to get free so we can keep sinning. Because that would make you a liar. But for true born again believers, you hate the sin. The problem is you hate yourself at times. Come on. And if you hate yourself based on what you do, when you see somebody do the same thing you do, it reminds me of you, and you despise you, you're going to despise somebody else. You can't love another until you know you're loved. I get it. I'm walking it out 17 years. And I'm excited this morning because I think we're going to get some freedom, some more freedom. Because the more free you are, the more you can just do all things through Christ. And you can love well, man. And there's nothing you can't do. But we have to deal with this issue of sin after the cross. Let's first look at the scriptures in John 1:29. We first have to understand that our sin is gone. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." So Jesus is going to take away the sin of the world. Does that include your sin?
Yes. Yes.
Then why do you remember it? And then why do you remember someone else's sin? Come on.
Come on now.
Jesus has taken the sin of the world away. I'm telling you, somebody's getting free today. So Jesus became sin for us and bore our sin in his body on the cross, thus fulfilling the law. I got a lot of scriptures today, so I'm going to run through them. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. You are righteous in Christ before God.
Amen.
When God sees you, he doesn't see your sin. You are righteous before the Father. Come on.
Amen.
Because of Christ's righteousness in you. You're covered in the blood. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, this is a freedom, man. But again, this stain of falling short, this stain of knowing him and sinning, this battle, this frustration, this pain of sinning before God and calling his name and becoming at times a hypocrite and seeing your weakness, to be able to get through that based because of his love is what we're talking about today. There is no relief. Listen, there is no relief until we submit to him and believe him. Where do we run to get rid of that pain of shame, of our guilt? And nothing else works but God. Knowing he accepts us. Knowing he forgives us. Knowing he loves us. That's the only relief I get. I wouldn't be able to stand up here this morning. And often we've gone to so many other places to get relief, and it just runs out. Until we get relief and comfort from God through the Spirit. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Hebrews 9:22. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Without the shedding of blood, your sins are blotted out. Although they were scarlet as red, they're blotted out. But we still have to deal with sin after the cross. Although they're blotted out, we still sin. How do we deal with that? And that's where a lot of people are stuck. He don't love me. How could he? Look at me. I can't believe I did this. The guilt and the shame and the condemnation is not of God. But I will tell you, there is holy conviction. Hallelujah. See, we can't be on one extreme side. Grace, grace, grace. Oh, it's okay. You're okay. Everyone's okay. Everyone's sinning. It's fine. It's okay. I don't want to hurt you. No, that's not love. That's enablement. Right? Truth in love is what we need all the time. So we have to understand, when we think about the cross, that Jesus became our, he took our sin, he became sin for us. His shed blood covered our sin. Although we were dead in our sins and transgressions, without God and without hope in the world, on our way to hell, Christ came at the right time and died for us while we were yet sinful and didn't know him, and now in him we're completely loved and accepted and redeemed and forgiven. This is great. But we shall be tested in that. So now we have peace with God. In Romans, I believe it's chapter, I'm missing the chapter. Legalism. Chapter 5. Is that what it is? Peace with God. Verse 5. Therefore, since we have been justified by religious works, it doesn't say that. Since we've been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Are we still looking to get peace with God, to get right with God based on our effort? Or have we determined that Jesus did it for me? One is freedom, the other one is bondage. Have you determined that you have peace with God, you are right with God, things are all good with God, because of what Jesus did in your faith in him, or are you still trying to obtain peace by your good behavior? We have to examine this today. Because if you're stuck in a works gospel, then you're not secure in Christ, and it's pride. It's still saying, God, I can do it apart from Christ. I got it. I can do it. Up and down, like a roller coaster. So we go in and out of favor with God based on our effort, depending how good we're doing. You can do, for a month, man, I'm not smoking cigarettes. I'm praying for people. I get up early at 5:00. I'm praying. Things are great. And then on day 31... you blow it. I thought it was a cigarette. It was marijuana on the floor. I couldn't help myself. I just blew it. You don't love me Does he still love you?
Yes.
So much.
Yeah. Yes. That never changes. His love isn't dependent on you. Hallelujah. His love is not dependent on your actions. He chose to love us when we were what? How much more now that we're in Christ? Come on. Somebody's getting goosebumps. Oh, I love this. It's so good. I needed it so much. I'll tell you who needs it. I do. Because I'm you. You're me. We're all human. And if we're in Christ, we have to work together and love one another and help each other. So all that is pride. So let us have the right foundation. It's what Jesus did, not what we did. And it also then is what Jesus does after we come to know him. He don't say, okay, I saved you. Now, good luck, guys. Go. Hope it works out for you. No. God completes the work he starts. And we're going to get into those scriptures as well. Through him, Christ, we also obtained access by faith into the grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. And endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Okay, so God pours his love. I don't know how he does it. Is it a, I don't know, is it a wagon full, a cup? I'm not, it's a lot, though. But he pours his love into your heart through the Holy Spirit. Are you doing that? Remember, God is doing all this in us. This is going to take the pressure off us, huh? Of performance. I got to do this, I got to do that. We've got to, God wants to live his life through us. And the more we rest and trust him and accept his love in our weakness, in our sin, in our doing well, and whatever it may be, we can trust him and rest. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Was everyone ungodly before they came to Christ? The whole world is guilty before God. There's not one righteous, not even one. So we're in good company. Would you say so? No one's better than anybody else except God. Amen? He's better than everyone else. He's the best. Number one. Amen. It says, for while we were still weak at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare to even die. But God shows his love for us that in while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood. Now stay right there. Now that we've been justified, meaning when you stand before God, you are declared, ready? Not guilty. You're justified by his blood. Where does that have to do with your ability to go to church, read your Bible, and pray at 5 a.m? Where are we justified by our own ability to do the right thing in order for God to justify us? That is a works gospel, and it's from Satan. And there are religions that name the name of Jesus that will teach you that. Run far from them. It is a false gospel. Any one that brings you a different gospel than the one that is we're given in the scriptures, run from. Just because it has the name Jesus on it doesn't mean it's Jesus. That's why you got to know your word. Amen. We're justified by the blood. So if we're justified by the blood, then what do I have to do apart from being justified by the blood in order to be justified? Do I got to be baptized? Do I got to do certain sacraments? What do I got to do? Nothing from nothing equals nothing. Come on. Got to have Jesus if you want to be with me. Right? Nothing. We're justified by what? The blood. Now, if you can get up there and hang on a cross and die for the whole world, then it would be justified by your actions. But our blood doesn't work because our blood is sinful. Amen. Jesus, his blood, was poured out. And that's why he came, to be the sacrifice, to take our sin, to become sin for us, to take our place on a debt we owe that we couldn't pay that he took care of. His holy shed blood was poured out for all that believe their sins covered in the blood of Christ. And you're justified. Does that help you to not look at yourself and put pressure on you of performing for salvation and then after salvation? Does this help you to know that you're justified by the blood? It should. But we still have to deal with, okay, I believe that, but I'm still blowing it. I know I'm justified by the blood, but gosh, I sin and I hate it. Oh, okay, we'll get to that. But let's make sure we get the first things first. That you know you're loved and forgiven by the blood. That you're justified, reconciled, made right, holy, pure, righteous because of the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what makes you justified before God. The blood of Jesus Christ. So God, when he sees you, he don't see you. You know what he sees? The blood. He's pleased with his son. And if you're in his son, he's pleased with you because you're in the son. That's the work of what must we do to, the works to be saved? To believe in the one sent. To believe in Jesus as God, the Christ. This is the work of God. To believe in the son. Whoever has the Son has the Father. Whoever does not have the Son does not know the Father. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled, meaning made right to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. It's all paid for. The debt is over. The money you owed. The hell that you deserved. Every sin committed that had its consequence is paid for. That's why he said it's finished. Father, forgive them for they don't know what they do. It's finished. So now whoever comes to him, he will forgive and make him white as snow. Yes, I get it, but I'm still struggling with sin. How do I make that? How do I reconcile that? By believing the truth of knowing God. Believing God. Struggling with sin as a believer. Romans chapter 7. One of my favorite passages in scripture. And then it goes into Romans 8 verse 1. Which is the favorite scripture for me. We'll get to that later. But let's read about struggling with sin. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual. Sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is, it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me. That is in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I don't want to do, this I do. I am whacked. This I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. Oh! For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. I want to do the right thing. I want to please him. I know it's holy. I know it's good. But oh! This sin that lives in me, do it! I can understand his anguish, can't you? Maybe you don't express it quite verbally like that, but maybe some of you inside are screaming the same words. Maybe some of you are running and hiding because of the anguish of doing the things you don't want to do that you shouldn't do, and the good that you want to do, you don't do. But listen, it is sin that's working in me, but what is the answer? What is the hope? This guy right here, at this point, has no hope. As I read the scripture, this person does not have power to overcome. He's lost at sea. But not for long. Uh-huh. Because he says, what a wretched man I am. This is our true state. Trump, the Pope, me, you, your mom, your dad. What wretches we are before God. Every man, every woman, a wretch in the eyes of God. Pompous, arrogant, without hope and without God. Living as they choose. And God has mercy on them. As he had mercy on me and you and us all. And Paul says, wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ, our Lord. You see, it's important to take that next step to be grateful. See, without being grateful, without believing in Jesus, we end up being what? Ungrateful, angry, pissed, frustrated, full of guilt and shame without, because we're rejecting Christ, who is our hope for the very wretch that we are. He's the answer. Oh, wretches, will you run to him? To become a son, to become a daughter, and no longer a wretch, but a saint, adopted into the family of God, where you become a son or a daughter of God. And have the new identity, the new creation. Amen? Assurance. Can I have assurance, please? I'll take assurance for 500. Do we need assurance? Oh, yeah, we need it. Bad. As we see Paul struggling with sin, we can relate to it. And he then recognized, oh, wretch that I am, nothing I can do apart, but thanks be to God for Jesus Christ. I always use the example of Paul who says, wretched man, oh, but thank you, God. He's grateful. When you look at Judas, who is stealing from Christ, a wretch as well, correct? Any different than Paul? Paul was a murderer, and he was a Pharisee, and he was legalistic, and he was wise in his own understanding, and he was judgmental. And he was intelligent, and he was far advanced, and he was prideful. Was Paul any different than Judas? But yet, Paul said, thanks be to God for the Lord Jesus Christ. And Judas said, here's your money, and he went and hung himself. What was the difference? One believed, one was humble, the other was prideful. And his guilt and his shame led to his death. And his regret and his unbelief. That's why people kill themselves. Because there's no hope. There's no answer. There's no relief from the things they did or the things that were done to them. Come on. Some of you know what I'm talking about. But Paul said, wretched man that I am, thank you, God, for the Lord Jesus Christ. Who loves me and gave himself for me, who becomes my hope and my light, who becomes my everything, who becomes the one I go to. He's got the answers. He's given me power. He loves me when no one else may not. Now I get a reason for living, because I don't die. Because the thing I needed the most is to be forgiven of my sin, and only God could do that. And this is where our purpose and our for living begins, as we believe in Jesus. But as a believer, I'm trying to figure it out, and I still get old habits, and I still get old ways, and I still get old thoughts, and I screw up So I must what? Lean not on my own understanding, but I must see what God says about me. I need assurance. I'm desperate for God, for confidence. I need to know I'm loved. I need to know I'm secure. Don't you? I can sit up here and act like I'm great, but I'm not great on my own. I'm not great apart from Him. I've not accomplished anything good and true and holy if it wasn't by His grace. I need assurance. Does God, our Father, want us to have assurance? Does He want us to know? Of course He does. Of course He does. What kind of God would say, I don't want you to know. I want you to just be so insecure. You don't know if you're going to hell 1 minute or heaven the next. That's what I'm doing to you. I want my people freaked out, racked, up and down. I want you screwed up because I'm not going to tell you. What kind of God is that? Now listen, if that was the God of the Bible, I'd promote that. Because I'm going to tell people what He said, amen? But He tells us in Romans 8:1, you ready? You ready? Fasten your seatbelts, truth is coming. It's a short verse, but it's the best verse. Romans 8:1, so now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. Amen. Yeah, you can skip if you want. Either word is true or it's not. Do you believe it? So then why do you condemn yourself when you mess up, when you sin? Come on. Why do you condemn yourself? Why do you hide it? Why do you run? Why do you get miserable and angry and frustrated and pissed off because of you, what you did, not because they did, right? Well, that's another scenario. But we're talking about sin after the cross. Because you hate yourself because of the thing that you did. But if there is no condemnation, then are you still loved? Yes. Are you telling me you're loved when you curse somebody out? Yes. Who said no? Does God love you when you gossiped about that person? Does He love you when you watch pornography? Did He love you when you committed that adultery? Does He love you when you shot heroin? When you beat your kids or your wife or your... See, I can go on and on and on, guys. Does God love you in Christ? Period. Yes or no? Yes is the answer. Therefore, there is no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. This is not a license to sin. This is God's love for us. He's going to deal with the sin. And He shows us how. But there's no condemnation. Amen? Silent woman, silent. It's so important. Bless you, woman. Bless you. Glad you're here. Because you're loved and worth dying for. And all your failure, His love is greater. This is the only way I wake up in the morning. Assurance of my salvation. Philippians 1:6, and I am sure of this. Are you ready? I am sure of this. The scripture starts off with, I am sure of this. I love that. I'm sure of it. I believe it. I trust it wholeheartedly. That He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Who is going to finish the work in me? He who began it. Who's going to finish the work in you? It ain't you. And that's some of the problem. You try for a while, it doesn't work, this Christian thing. These holy freaks. The Bible stuff. I just don't feel like going. They don't know where I've been. Wah, wah. Lies, 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 all meant to get you out of God's will. All lies, man. It's you. It's always us. Oh, don't get me wrong. People can be stumbling blocks. There's stumbling blocks. There are those that hurt God's people. And there is a serious consequence for that. But mainly when we don't follow Christ, it's us. We can't blame it on somebody else. You want Christ and you'll go after him all messed up and you'll figure it out and you'll stay with him and you'll learn and you'll grow and you will love him and learn to love him and trust him because there's nowhere else to go. I don't know who else has the words of eternal life. Nobody. So why would you go anywhere else? Right? Philippians, John 5, verse 24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes, him who sent me has eternal life. Whoever hears my words and believes, him who sent me, the Father who sent the Son, has eternal life. Where is the works in that? There is none. All right, but I got it. But now after salvation, what do I do? He who believes in him who sent the Christ has eternal life. You have everything because you have the Son. Amen. And if you have the Son, you have the Spirit. You have everything because you have the Son. And who he has a Son has a Spirit. It's over. You're secure in Christ. I know, but I still sin. I know, we're talking about that. Relax. No! I want to know now. I just can't sleep, and I hate myself. That's, we're talking about that, okay? Does God hate you?
No.
Then believe God. That's our problem. This is our root. This is monumental. Does God hate me when I sin? No! Really? Oh! This is great! That doesn't make me want to sin. It makes me want to do right. It makes me want to love God. Aha, now we're getting somewhere. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you'll what? Obey my teachings. If you love me, you'll obey me. Oh, God's so good, I'm just going to want to obey him all the time. That's why I hate when I don't. Hallelujah. I love him. Why? Because he first loved me and gave his life for me. You see the freedom here? Where we're not working for salvation or we're not trying to work for it after we got it for free. Right? We meet Christ, we're saved by what? Grace through faith. Amen. Not of works, lest any man should boast. It's the gift of God. So it's a free gift. We take it. Oh, I'll take it. But then after we're saved, we want to try to pay for it? Are we saved just at the time that we call on Christ? And okay, now you're on your own. You're going to be good. What? That's not the gospel. Whoever believes in him who sent me has eternal life. Ready? He does not come into judgment, but has passed, ready, from death to life. Yeah, but I sin. Are you a believer? Yes! You've passed from judgment, and you have eternal life. This is good. Because I was really worried. Oh. John 3:36. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Thank you, Eddie. Did he just add to the scripture? Because I don't see that. Whoever believes, not whoever works. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. John 10:28, Jesus said, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. Do we believe that?
Yes.
So can you snatch you out of your hand? Can Satan snatch you out of your hand, out of his hand? I give them eternal life, and they will never, never perish. They might perish. They will never perish. Who's not going to perish? Those that believe. So does it matter what I do after the cross? Of course it matters. Is there any condemnation?
No.
Can I perish? No. Why? Because I'm believing God. If you just love sin after the cross, if you do whatever you want and there's no conviction, if you, right, you have to, God will tell you to examine to see if you're even in the faith. Some people after the cross come to the Christ but leave Jesus. Can they do that? Yes, because they have free will. I don't want this persecution. I don't want this Christ. I want my life. Can you reject Jesus verbally? Yes. But do his sons and daughters do that? No. His children don't reject him. They need him. His children sin and blow it, but they need him. If you reject and forsake Christ, you are not his son or daughter. Because his children know his voice. And his children need him and rely on him. Or at least learn to. First John 5:10-13. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. This is cut and dry. I write these things to you, ready? Who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. He don't want you to guess. He don't want you to be insecure about it. He wants you to know, because he's God. That's confidence. I tell people that when I meet them, I have eternal life. I don't die. Isn't that exciting? Nice to meet you. I'm Johnny. How are you? I don't die. Oh, this guy's a freak job. What's this guy? What are you talking about? Eternal life? You can't know if you got eternal life, buddy. What's wrong with you? You can't know that. That's what I used to think until I met Jesus Christ. Amen. Until I knew God who loved me and gave his life for me and forgave my sin. And I know it. He told me that. Oh, God doesn't tell you those. What the hell's wrong with you? You're going to hear these things out there, aren't you? You got to be prepared to give the testimony for the hope that's in you. Amen. If you got Jesus, you got eternal life. How do you hold that in? I mean, I don't get that. So what happens when you die? I live forever. I mean, get excited. Absent the body, present with the Lord, you live forever. We have eternal life. I write these things that you may know that you have eternal life, for those that what? Believe. In a moment, you die. Hey, I'm alive. Wow, that was quick. But it's true, isn't it? It's true. You have eternal life. Sometimes we're focused on all the wrong things. I live forever. That makes me grateful. It makes me happy, as the song said. But I still got a lot of problems. Right? I gotta always learn to focus on God and not myself. Because when I focus on me, I'm all what? Selfish. I'm self. I mean, I gotta get off that. That's all pride, and it's just okay, but does God love me? Yes, and this is where you're gonna get set free, because most of us think he doesn't love me because I'm such a wreck. because I'm so wicked and I know it and I know I'm messed up and roar. You have to tell me about me. I know I'm bad, you jerk. Okay, I'm wrong. I'm sorry. Right? Okay. But does God love you when you're all whacked out?
Yeah.
If he loved you when you were yet a sinner, how much more now that you're in Christ? Come on. It's receiving his love that is going to settle your heart. Because it becomes less about you and what everyone else does or doesn't do. And it becomes about God. Listen, many of us are still running around. You're trying to meet your own needs. And you use everyone and you get mad at everyone because they don't do what you want to do. And you know why? Because you're not God. But you expect people to do what you want. That comes from God. You follow me? So we got to go, okay, God, will you meet my needs? Right? You got to ask God, would you meet my needs? Yes. Once God begins to meet your needs, because he knows what you need. We don't even know what we need. I just wanted it. I just needed that those shoes, the yellow ones. If I don't have them, I don't even know why. I just need them. You don't need them. Take them off. Throw them out. Can we enjoy a nice period? Yeah. Because it doesn't own us. Nothing owns us but God. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Assurance. Romans 10:9, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now listen, people, there's this whole thing on, saying a prayer. Should people call on the name of the Lord? Is it biblical? Yes. Should we tell people that they're saved when they call on the name of the Lord? No. No, we shouldn't. You know who should tell us? They should. See, in other words, when people, I'm talking about unbelievers now, when people hear the gospel, should we invite them to call on the Lord Jesus Christ? Absolutely, it's biblical. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord after hearing, right, shall be saved. Are they saved in that moment? That's up to them and God. Follow me, that's up to God rather, right? But when they believe it, that has to come from them. So we should never tell people, oh, you said a prayer, you're saved. What we said is you called on Christ, hallelujah, and he's faithful to save you. Do you believe right now? No, not yet. Okay, that's okay. But did you call on Christ? Yes, but nothing happened. Okay, well, when it does, you will all know about it. Guess what? I'm saved. Oh, my God, I can't believe it. I'm forgiven. He loves me. I'm forgiven. Jesus Christ is God. He's God. He loves me.
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord. I don't even know what happened. It was a dream. I'm not sure, but it happened. Who told you Jesus was? I don't know. God or something. I don't even know what happened. You see, we get stuck sometimes. Sometimes you can share the gospel with people and just talking about bringing the good news, they went from not knowing where they're going when they die and not knowing if they're loved, and in 5 minutes, they believe. See, when the Holy Spirit comes, and the Holy Spirit is wooing people, right? Some believe by hearing the gospel. Some, they have to call on him, and God is faithful to save them, and it may not be that moment where they believe. We should never tell somebody that. And I used to do that. I used to share Christ with people and lead them in the sinner's prayer. And whenever I get to the part where it says to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, all right, to repeat after me, Jesus is Lord. I believe that you're Lord. And they go, I believe that you're Lord. But they don't believe it. Right? So you have to examine what the scriptures say. It's not about us leading people to Christ. It's about God saving his people and us telling the truth with the testimonies that are in us of the hope that we have and presenting the gospel, right? Leading people to the Christ that they would make a choice, and we should lead them to make a choice. Would you like to, do you believe in Christ? No, not yet. Would you like to believe? Yeah, I do. I really do. Would you call the name of the Lord? Yes, Jesus, save me. Okay. Do you believe yet? No. But what? I just want. Okay, great. You took the first step. Because you called on a God you couldn't see. And you called on his name. Jesus, the Christ. Save me. And if you heard and you hear testimonies throughout this ministry, you often hear people that called on Christ in the shower with the razor and the blood dripping down, on the side of the road with a needle in the arm, or after a night of abuse from a male. A person decided, Jesus, save me. After hearing the gospel that our sin deserves hell, people make a choice, Jesus, save me. And every time, God is faithful to save you. Why? Because his word says it. He just loves it. He loves when people say yes to him. Why? Because he's God and he made you and he's jealous, and his people have went everywhere else but him. They went to the women and the drugs and the men, and they went to the drink, and they went to the shopping, and they went to stuff to feel good because they were so without and so broken and so lonely, and the Father made him and he's jealous, and they gave themselves to another like a whore. They committed adultery over and over. Because the Prince Charming came in, or the woman that was going to complete them come in, or the job. We found identity and purpose and everything but God, and he weeps, and his heart is broken, and his son hung and said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. He shed his blood for the whole world, and he says, go, my people, and tell them about me. Tell them they'll go to hell, but they don't have to. Tell them the Son is God. Tell them about me. And we tell them, and he loves when you say, yes, God. I mean, how excited is God when his people say, I choose you freely and of my own volition, of my own choice. You don't have to tell me, I want to be saved. I want to be forgiven. I want to be loved. I don't care what anyone else thinks, because I can't get love anywhere else. I mean, you think God is excited about that? That person can come, and they could be the worst sinner on the planet. The 5-year-old boy who was molested and raped by his father, who grew up with feelings of homosexuality, who hated himself and covered his pain with drugs, who then molested other children, became a pedophile, and hated himself and went to jail. He, like me, like you, like all of us, when we hear the gospel, can come and say, save me, heal me, forgive me. And Jesus says, yes. The Father accepts the Son, that person, no matter who, what they've done, and forgives them utterly and completely by the blood of Christ. For no one is any different than the other. And if we think we are, then we are prideful and self-righteous. If God forgives you, then that's all you need. And your soul will be satisfied. Wow. This is how I wake up. I can't wake up without believing that. In 17 years, I have sinned often and then learned to sin less. But I still sin. The only relief I could get would be because I have to know and I believe that I'm a son and that he loves me, and I'm not condemned ever, and I'm washed and I'm holy, but I get things to work out. That's the confidence that I have and need desperately, and so do you. And you then can live free. And you can become, be honest. Because you're fully accepted by God. Yeah, but if they knew, they wouldn't love me. It's okay, God does. Yeah, but they don't accept me. No, God does. Yeah, they don't forgive me. God does. Wow. That's exciting. Okay, this love thing is getting a little, it's kind of getting good. I'm kind of believing. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now listen to this. Listen to this carefully. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. So when we say a prayer for somebody, right? If they don't believe in their heart and they're just mouthing words that you tell them to repeat, are they believing in their heart? No. It's not about say this line, say these words. It's not a magic potion, right? If you believe in your heart after hearing, then what? You'll confess with your mouth. That's why I can't shut up. What you believe in your heart is what's coming out of your everything. Whatever comes out of your heart, out of your mouth, is what's in your heart. Jesus is Lord! I'm acquitted. I'm not just saying that because someone told me to say that. I called on Christ and he was faithful to save me. It was 6 years after I called on him that he saved me. Why? Because he's faithful to save all who call on the name of the Lord. Amen. It's exciting. Romans 8:38, more assurance. For I'm sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor the things present, nor the things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So what can separate you from his love? Nothing from nothing, man. Nothing. I mean, walk around with that assurance all day. What are you going to be upset? Nothing separates me. I can't believe it. Just hoping to be separated. Come on. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. He loves you. He loves us continually. Romans 8:28, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Let this not just be a scripture. Now, for those who love God, why do they love God? Because they had the ability to love God? Because they always knew God? No, because God loved them first. That's what scripture says. Because God loved us, we now love him. Amen? So, for those that have received and accepted his love, all things work together. Does that mean your sin? So you really blew it a number of times. Does God promise to cause that to work together somehow for your good? So he's gonna benefit you in your sin? Yes. Anybody experience the goodness of God that way? Come on. Right here, you're looking at one of them. I'm 17 years. I've been working that out. Right? Gave the vision of so many things that have come to pass. He just wants our hearts. Amen? Just truth in the innermost being. He causes all things to work together for good. Does that mean sometimes that God might take a son or a daughter home at 23 years old? Sure. Young Nick went home at 23, OD'd, on two pills. But for years he was sent all over the country to different men of God, and he just kept dabbling. God has the right to decide who and what he has mercy on. And for him, his him going home to be with God, working things out for good in his life. Yes. Isn't that the best thing? But we don't want to die in shame and sin, but doesn't mean we're not his children. Amen? So we have to just not lean on our own understanding, but accept God. Because we'll look at that scripture and go, oh, that means everything you do, it doesn't matter what you do, you're going to be fine, man. Oh, that's great. I'm just going to keep doing the lines then. That's cool. No, but you see how twisted that is? Some people will actually think that. Well, I can just go, I can sin. It doesn't matter. It's going to work out. Yeah, well, God had a ministry for you, and he had a family for you. Now you're 30 years in prison. Now, he'll still use that. It's still going to work out for you. But I didn't have you. Do you follow what I'm saying? It's going to work out. I'm glad that you're obedient. You love me in jail now, and praise God. That's God working things out. But he never wanted you to go and rob the store to begin with. Do you follow me? But I am grateful that God, no matter what, he's always benefiting us. That's why we don't keep tempting the Lord. We don't keep resisting God. But his mercy is powerful. It's just crazy how merciful he is. One, 1 John 2, 1-2. Again, how am I dealing with sin after the cross? Assurance. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate, the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not only for us only, but also for the sins of the whole world. He's saying, children, I don't want you to sin. That's the goal. Does God want you to be holy? Does he want you to live every moment doing the right thing? Yes. Does he give you power to do that? The power of the Holy Spirit. And the fact that you've been forgiven from the law and breaking it, that there's no penalty, you can uphold it now. Because there's no penalty. Why? Because of the blood, remember? So I can do what's right. If, and that's God's goal, that we should not sin, but if we do, he says we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. It says that God's grace abounds, ready, in our sin. You know how you get out of sin and you find healing and love? Has anyone sinned against the Lord? And you had the pain and the shame, and somehow you were absolutely forgiven and loved by God? Yeah. That's called God's grace abounding in your sin. That the Holy Spirit is active in interceding. Are you ready? On your behalf, while you're all twisted up. I'm going to get high, but I don't want to. I want to hate my uncle. I'm going to kill him. My daughter's... The Holy Spirit is interceding while you're all freaking out. Because God loves you. That's love. Trying to reach you, teach you, and we resist and fight and things go wrong, and because he's waiting for us to believe him. One applause. Shame on you. I'm kidding. Shame. I thought I was paid at the cross. What's going on there? It's kind of controlling. What kind of guy is that? It's a cult. Okay. Oh, man. Let's just stretch it out. Everyone just stretch it out. God is good. Come on, we're loved. Come on, freedom's come. More freedom. There we go. One guy in the back, the one fitness guy. He's all... God's standard for us is that we would not sin. Amen? Amen. Accept that. That's good. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar. The truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. So God's people who have the Spirit, if you have Christ, you have the Spirit. God wants us to walk holy, and it's his work in our life to transform us in the image of his Son. God is transforming us to be like Jesus Christ, to be like our Father. Amen? That's the work of sanctification in your life. That's why it's hard, but don't give up. Because he's changing you so that you overcome that pain, that addiction, that lust, that insecurity. Come on. He's working in your life so you can be free in Christ. Don't despise that chastening of the Lord. I had to ask forgiveness 70. This is the seventh time today. Praise God, you got that grace. The other guy's 47. It's only like a half hour in the morning. Guys. Don't we need that grace? Because you're going to start sinning less. Hallelujah. Anybody experiencing that? Are you sinning less? One person. This is really... All right, come on. Who sins less since you met Jesus Christ? It's a lot of hands. That's a lot of power. That's a miracle. And you didn't take a forgiveness pill. Yeah, at the Walgreens, I'm here for my prescription. Yeah, I was... Yeah, they said it would help me with bitterness. Oh, you don't have it? You son of a... You... I'm bitter. I need that pill. Hi, is this Walmart? Yes. May I pick up my prescription? Yeah, it's supposed to help me with my unforgiveness. And you follow me? This is what the world does. This guy's freaking out. This one's biting his fingernails off. This one is choking himself. This one has extreme masturbation. I mean, it's just like crazy. Sorry, there's a child. I didn't see the child. She don't know what it is. Talk to her later anyway. They need to know about Jesus. Come on. You don't think at 6 or 7 we know what's going on? I'm going to tell you something. Think about it. I was at 6 and I knew what that guy was doing to me. I knew the shame of rejection at 7 and 8. I knew what it was to hate people at 9. Do you follow what I'm saying? Amen. We're little people. We need the truth. Don't we? Why not tell the truth to our little ones? So then they can know the truth. Amen? And that stuff smells fantastic back there. It's killing me. The gospel is like a sweet aroma. Or bacon. One of the two. I'm not sure. That's funny. I'm excited today. God is good, isn't he? Man, he's helping us with all our crap. Isn't it great? That weight that we carried, the offense, the bitterness, we were pissed. I mean, life was terrible. Oh. Exactly. Come on up, Keith.
He's a guitar man.
Thank you very much. You're a beautiful crowd. I think it's a good measurement where he says if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And you'll know them by their fruit. If you know the Lord and you want to do right, you want to serve him, you want to keep his commandments. And today we're talking about sin after the cross. And we need to clear the air with God that our failings, in our failings, we're loved still. We're still approved. We're still accepted. Come on. The blood still cleanses us. 1 John 1:7-9. But if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we claim we have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. Let us honor one another, and let us now, as God always calls for an action. Yeah, you can wait. You can do it later. And that's fine, you know? Some of us, we might be uncomfortable. But let us close our eyes, respect our neighbor, and let's just, okay, it's you and God. And if you have small children, hold on to them. But everyone, let's close your eyes, and this is your time with God. If we are living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with one and with each other, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. Let us come to him as his children, and let us confess our sins and be cleansed. Will you get free this morning and receive his love and forgiveness? If you're a believer right now and you say, you know, when I sin, I don't accept myself. When I sin, I don't believe I'm still loved. Would you just go to God and say, God, would you change my heart and help me to know that you love me no matter what I do, right or wrong? Would you just ask him that? Lord, I want assurance. Tell him I want assurance. Lord, give me an assurance and a confidence that when I blow it, you love me, and that there's nothing that I've done that's unforgivable, that it's all paid for. So forgive me, Lord, for resisting your love. Would you just say, Lord, forgive me for resisting your love. And help me to know your love in a greater way. And if you're a believer right now and there's just sin that you've committed that you just are ashamed of, right now, just give it to your Father. You're bitter, you're angry, there's judgment, there's lust, there's whatever it may be, just talk to the Father and confess it. Father, I give you my anger that causes me to sin. Whatever it may be, just confess it. It's okay. You're at the throne. If you're a believer, you're in the throne room and you're accepted because you come in the name of Jesus. Because you have, you're covered in the blood of Jesus. So you're already a son. You don't have to hide. Just give it to him. Lord, I hate myself. Give it to him. I hate my husband. Give it to him. Come on. Get rid of it. Confess it. Lord, show me how to trust you. And now, why do you wait? Rise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling out his name. If there be any in this room today that you can say, I do not know this Jesus that you preach. I do not know that I'm born again. I do not know that if I died, I would not go to hell or heaven. I do not believe. I do not know Jesus Christ. But this I do know, that I am guilty before God. If that's you today, would you call on the name of Yeshua? Would you, right where you are, say, Jesus, save me? If that's you, would you just slide your hand and say, I'm calling on Jesus right now? If that's you, and you want to be forgiven, you want to know that you're loved and accepted, would you let us have the honor to pray for you? Just slip up your hand and say, I'm calling on, amen. Anyone else? I'm calling on Jesus right now. I want to know him more. I want to be saved. Anybody else? Bless you, brother. Bless you. Bless you. Yes. 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 Bless you. Come on, man. This is exciting. The devil is a liar. And right now, for those who lifted their hands, you said yes to God. And you tell him yourself, Jesus, save me. Wash me. Forgive me. I want to know you. I want to be forgiven. And I've heard you died for me, but help me to believe. Right now, say, give me faith to believe. If that's you, would you say, God, give me faith and understanding of the gospel Yes, Lord. Bless them, Lord. Father, I pray that there would be good ground, Lord God. Lord, I understand that we can't control when they know you and how they know you. But I pray, God, right now, as when I heard, I didn't believe for years because I didn't think I was good enough. So I pray over their life, Father, that they would know that they don't have to be good enough. They would just have to know you, that you're God, Jesus. So I pray that their faith is strong, that they're good ground. God, that you would move radically in their lives. God, that they would be free. God, I pray over your family, your children. God, we've blown it miserably, so bad at times. So anyone here, God, that's your son, that's your daughter, that when they sin, they doubt their salvation, they doubt their love, they hate themselves. God, would you show them that you don't hate them? Help them to receive and believe you, that you love them, and that you will fix them and you will heal them as they begin to trust in you. I pray over that over each and every person in this room. We bless your name in Jesus' name. May God bless you today and walk in freedom. Amen. You can thank the Lord. He's good.